Friday, August is 28th. I think the agenda says 27th. There's meeting of the Prescott Park Master Plan Implementation Committee. I'd like to begin with a roll call of the committee members and others attending. We'll start with Genevieve.
Genevieve Achel, 47 Orchard Street, and I'm the only one here.
Alan? Alan, your mute button is still on.
Thank you. Alan Gordon, 620 Woodbury, and I'm the only one here.
Petra?
Petra Huda, 280 South Street, and I'm here with my family and dogs.
Beth?
Beth Margeson, 24 Marcy Street. I'm in our study alone, but my husband and children are elsewhere in the house.
Robin?
Robin Lori Meyerkoff, 53 Whidden Street. I'm here in my sunroom, and my husband and son are in another part of the house.
And I'm Tom Watson. I'm here at my office by myself at 501 Islington Street. City staff, Nancy?
Sure, Nancy Culver-Puff, Deputy City Manager. I'm here in City Hall.
Peter?
Peter Rice, Director of Public Works. I am at my office with all the regular staff around the building.
Okay. Is Joe going to be joining us, or?
I do not believe Joe will be joining us this morning. He has prior commitments.
Okay. And our consultants, Sherry?
Hi, Sherry Ruane, and I'm actually in Washington, D.C.
Good for you.
Surprise.
Savvy?
Savvy Kep, I'm in Saugus, and in the building across the hall is my brother taking a college class at the moment.
Great. Will Ted or anyone else be joining us?
No, just us today.
Okay. All right. So I'll begin the meeting reading the usual proclamation. Per New Hampshire RSA 91-A:23B, the chair has declared that COVID-19 outbreak an emergency and has waived the requirement that a quorum be physically present at the meeting. Pursuant to the governor's executive order 2020-04, section 8, as extended by executive order 2020-5 and emergency order number 12, section 3. Members will be participating remotely and will identify their location and any person present with them at that location. All votes will be taken by roll call. All right, so let's begin with the minutes of our August 14th meeting. I will entertain a motion to approve them.
So moved, but there's some corrections to them, Tom.
Okay, if I get a second, we'll deal with the second.
Second.
Okay, all right, so corrections, additions, deletions?
I would just note that Joel Mita wasn't at that meeting, not to rat him out, but he had a doctor's appointment that day. So he wasn't an attendee. And then on page two, very top, I talked about getting input. And I didn't say, not only do we fail to get input, I said that, you know, we do get input, but the vast majority of people don't know that something is being done until it's actually being done. So just want to make that clear.
Okay. Other corrections? Any omissions? Okay. Everybody, I guess we'd have to do a roll call. All in favor of adopting the minutes as corrected by Beth? We'll start with, I guess, Genevieve.
Yes.
Alan? You're waving, Alan,
yes.
But okay.
Yes.
Petra?
Yes.
Beth?
Yes.
Robin?
Yes.
And the chair votes yes. Okay. Sherry, would you like to take us into the public outreach?
Absolutely. All right. So welcome. Today we're going to go through some slides based on the stuff we talked about last time, and we just want to confirm a couple things with you all in preparation for launching into the public engagement. So here's our project team, and we've added you guys as important members of how this is all moving forward. And what we'll talk about today is the project schedule, which we're all pretty familiar with at this point, the public engagement process outline, and then updated draft phasing diagram and cost summary. So we are here and we want to schedule this public engagement. We've been talking about it, strategizing about it. We want to really launch it in the next few weeks, end of September probably, and have it run for 4 to 6 weeks, and we'll go through that in a moment. Once that's completed, we can then get into final design, preparing of bid documents, with the hope that we can have an actionable phase one for spring, for the start of the construction season. So this slide has a lot of information. I'm going to leave it up for a minute and walk us through it. But essentially, this is to define the public process timeline. So as we're strategizing about how this plays out, and again, no dates have been set in this moment, but we do want to confirm in this meeting when we will begin. The idea is that third or fourth week in September, there'll be a first virtual public meeting. We'll be preparing materials ahead of that, obviously, and that meeting is going to recap the master plan and the report, emphasize the park first approach, talk about the project schedule. We're also going to include the enabling engineering and the resilient preservation update that we've been learning about, talk about the implementation of phase one and what those priorities are, diagram those out so they're quite clear, and then just lay out how we'll be getting feedback from folks. It'll start at that meeting, but then there'll be an interim period where there'll be online content that's available for review. So the presentation will be uploaded, we'll record the initial presentation, we'll upload it, as well as having surveys or polls that people can take to provide feedback. We'll collect all of this information. We will review it with you and city staff to come up with then a final preferred phase one, and then we will report back end of October, beginning of November, have another virtual public meeting that we again will record and report out. We'll have survey graphics to say this is what we heard in this interim period. So anything that we need to adjust based on public feedback, city staff, Blue Ribbon Committee, we will do that. And the intent then is to roll that out. We've found that this is a really successful way to engage folks during these times when we can't meet in person. And what we'd like to do in between in this interim period is potentially have drop-in times when people can log on and ask questions. So this is just a little bit more detail about what we'd be providing. The live presentation with that enabling engineering and resiliency preservation findings, this open discussion, and then being able to assess feedback from folks. This online content review, this is what I was talking about in the as number two. This is times when we'll set, it might be a Tuesday from noon to 1:30, and then a Thursday from 6 to 7:30 p.m. and then a morning, a different time, but it's an opportunity for folks to log in and talk to the design team, including probably a representative from the Blue Ribbon Committee and city staff, but it just allows them to check in with us and ask specific questions. So we also will advertise the public engagement. I'm in the middle of my meeting. Sorry.
advertise the public engagement through social media to make sure that folks can share it and it can be shared widely. And we have successfully done this on a few other projects, and we've gotten a lot of good networking out of that. So we're optimistic about making sure that the word gets spread far and wide so people know about it. That second virtual public meeting, it will be a live presentation of design updates and then the project process. And then really we want to also, we'll moderate this discussion, and there's a couple ways we can do that, but make sure that we're communicating that we're listening, obviously. A couple of things that we can do in these virtual public meetings is there's an overlay, a digital overlay called Slido that allows people to type in questions, and everyone that's attending that meeting sees the questions. And if they like the question, or they agree with the question, or they would ask that question, they can upvote that question, like thumbs up that question. So the question with the most thumbs ups gets prioritized, and it allows us to moderate a really vibrant discussion, not unlike what we did a couple of times in the public process when we were in council chambers. Folks would write their questions on postcards, we'd collect them, and then we'd organize them. So if four people were asking the same question, we knew to address that first. So that's another option in this virtual world. So I think that's it for public engagement, and I want to take a break just to see if anybody has any questions about this process, because I know it might not have been perfectly clear last time we spoke.
Beth. Oh, I'm sorry. It looked like you were raising your hand, Beth.
I have a Robin? Question. Yep.
Yes, Robin.
So what methods are we going to use to get this information out there that this is happening? I think that there should be many different ways of getting this out to people.
Yeah. So it will be posted on all of the typical city websites. We do have mailing information from the public outreach process in the master plan itself. We can post things in the park, which is often effective. We're able to, you know, print small yard signs that we actually put in the park. So folks that are using the park now will be able to see that. We've also done social media posts, which we link back to the city landing page, so people see it and then can click back there. And we also can access various listservs and groups associated with Portsmouth. So the intention is to use both analog and digital means to get the word out as much as possible. It's a little harder now because people aren't out and about as much, but definitely there are still people using the park and sharing it with like the South End Neighborhood Association and things like that.
Other questions? Okay.
I have a question.
Okay, Petra.
Are we going to do a final review through the committee of what's going to actually be presented here? I don't recall us actually voting on the final plan and voting on the sync up of the final plan to the master plan. So
correct.
I'm not really clear about what we're actually going to be putting out to the public to look at.
Right.
So I kind of want to review and make sure we all agree on what's going to go out there and that we have the process in the committee down and know what's going to be seen by the public before we actually go out there. So right now,
absolutely,
I'm not really clear on that.
Yeah, we're going to go over that information next, right after this part, with the intention of getting closer to that point where we all agree what's going to be discussed. So we can get into that next and then we can talk further about that. But yes, Petra, the intention is that the content is set and you guys are aware of everything before we roll it out.
Because the other question I would have is on our final discussion points to go out to the public, is the committee supposed to vote on this or vote on the final version of the plan? I guess that question would be for Tom.
At what stage do you mean, Petra?
Well, what I mean is we saw a presentation where we were discussing the phases and then we readjusted the phases. And then I was not really clear that I saw anything that was a final of when we switched it to do the to for the remediation to be first and then the first section and the new buildings. I'm not really clear on what is actually included. I know we discussed it, but I didn't know if we had a final decision. And my question is of procedure. Does the committee need to vote on this and say, okay, we all agree on this, or we like this, we don't like this, and this is what we want to go to the public with?
Yes, well, my take on it, first of all, I don't think we've agreed on any proposal at this point. And my own personal observation is that one of the things this committee has got to struggle with is juggling the anticipated revenues versus the cost of each one of these central components of phase one. But I think that, I don't think we should make a decision before the public process, but I think we have to have sort of a proposed model for the, or plan for the public to comment on. I think we've got to give them something that they can focus on, as opposed to just saying, here's where we're at and listen to the same stuff we have and what do you think? So, and then at the end of that process, after we can conclude the entire public process, I think it's incumbent upon us to make a recommendation to the City Council on the what we think should be included in the phase one, what we think the anticipated cost of that is, and if it involves modifying the master plan, then our recommendation that the City Council so modify it.
I guess my concern, Tom, is that if there is modifications that we want to make to the master plan, are we telling the public something that is false information because the master plan hasn't been adjusted? The example is some of the new buildings that were proposed but not in the master plan. Do we need to go back to the council before we actually go out to the public? Because are they going to be looking at stuff that's not an option at that time? That's one of my concerns.
Sure, no, absolutely. But so I guess this is a little bit of a chicken and the egg situation. I'm not sure that we can really go to the City Council now and simply say, we think we're going to need to change the master plan. You know, will you give us authority to do that? Actually, we're not going to do any of it. We're just going to make recommendations. But, and you know this better because you're on the City Council, but what I expect is that what the City Council would want is for us to come to them having evaluated the engineering studies and the resiliency needs and say, this is how we think the master plan needs to be adjusted. It's up to the city to make that adjustment. So I think for the public process, the public probably just needs, we need to inform them that we're an advisory committee and this is what we're proposing to recommend to the City Council. The City Council is the only one that can change that master plan.
Okay, thank you.
Does that make sense? Or still questions? Or
no, that's good. I don't know if you want to call it false hope or false information out there of our process and where we actually are. I don't want to go out to the public prematurely and say, oh, this is for you to decide when we know we have to go back and adjust that master plan, if that is the way we need to go.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And in some ways, it's like the adoption of the original master plan. I mean, it was a master plan committee. It went through this entire process and ultimately came up with a product. But that product had to be approved by the City Council after its own public input process.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Other questions of?
Yeah. I just want to comment on, I think the overall and overriding tone of any public session, including this one, is number one, that even though we've been meeting among ourselves, that our overall goal is that we maintain transparency and that if people have input, we have a way on an ongoing basis to demonstrate that their input actually counts and is heard. So I just think that we could easily devolve into presenting what we've done, but I want to, at every meeting or at every opportunity, reiterate those 2 points.
Agreed. Other other comments or questions of Sherry? Okay. So Sherry, do you want us to pick dates now, or do you want to go through the next discussion and then we'll come back and do that?
Why don't we get through the next discussion and then we'll come back to it. We've got a couple dates that we'd like to propose to you guys. So let's get through this and then we'll do that.
Sounds good.
So we updated some of this information just so it's more clear. So the draft phasing plan we talked about last time, you know, how these phases were going to be laid out, with one being this core of the park with including some of the seawall components, as well as the proposed maintenance facility. Then second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth phases following behind. But just so that it's more clear, Savvy's helped pull this out so we can see that phase one does include some of the seawall components as well as this maintenance facility. And then we went so far as to just to walk everyone through sort of the order of operations. What is the sequence that these improvements have to happen in? Because there are basic site tectonics that require us to do things in a certain order. So if we're looking at the phase one area, which is essentially this dashed line on this aerial, this is essentially just a schematic model of what that looks like. And then if you can see that the stage is in the middle, and then we've got the Shaw and the two additional buildings along this rail, as well as some of the seawall and beach components. So the first thing we need to do is address specific seawall components. This is not a wholesale remove and replace the seawall. This is identifying the most vulnerable places. These are just diagrammatic at this point to show that it's just specific areas. They would be rebuilt and stabilized. Some of the infrastructure in the seawall would be improved to prohibit backflow from rising tides. And also in some cases, we might choose to raise the level of the seawall by adding additional courses of granite blocks. That's going to help protect, essentially, these investments. And that is first and foremost the first step to this phase one. The next thing are stormwater improvements. And as we talked about, we really want to create a preferential flood pathway through the park, which is actually now Water Street, which is really low. It's at a 6.5 elevation. But we know that the water, as it rises between tide, but also stormwater, it's gonna get upwards of 10 feet up to the 10-foot mark. So we need to create this preferential flood pathway down Water Street. And that means raising the elevation of Water Street a bit and putting subsurface pipes under the street to allow stormwater to move through the park without flooding it. Once we do that, we're effectively impacting the elevation of Water Street. So once we do that, now the relationship between the street and the buildings becomes strained. So I don't believe it's prudent or physically, I mean, anything's possible with time and money, but if we're looking at things in an order of operations. Once we've improved the stormwater conditions on Water Street, we also then need to manage the Shaw. We need to raise it and we need to relocate it, because now we've changed the surrounding conditions around that building. So the next piece would be raising and relocating the Shaw. from the flood paths. Also, the E is showing new electrical service. We'd be removing the old transformer and consolidating the four different service points of the electricity to one. And it would probably be in this general area where that happens. And then we would remove the garage and the lean-to shift the stage. The next piece, we would be regrading, and that's what these lines are indicating. We're regrading the areas around the buildings and the relocated stage. And we're also regrading the performance lawn. And this performance lawn serves two purposes. It's graded to optimize audience viewing, but it's also graded to manage stormwater so that it can actually hold stormwater on the surface and then quickly allow it to move through the park. So it's twofold. It's an accommodate strategy for the water. And then this is all of these pieces sort of combined. So here's the existing conditions. We stabilize the seawall first and foremost. And of all the phases, of all the pieces of phase one, that's the one piece that could be done completely independently. It doesn't necessarily trigger any other improvements. It could be done independently and it can be finished and still interface with the existing conditions of the park without strain. It's the next one, the subsurface stormwater management, that really starts to trigger a lot of these other moves. So raising Water Street, adding the subsurface stormwater management, then triggers moving the Shaw, removing the garage and the lean-to, creating the maintenance facility over at Four Tree Island, and then regrading the site. So as we look at the costs, that's really the most important thing to keep in mind, is that number one, we believe of all the things, and the list is long of things that we believe the park would benefit from, we're prioritizing really these first, these site improvements and electricity improvements, and then this building. But really, if you only could do one thing, it's stabilizing the seawalls and improving the utilities that interface with the seawall that can be done independently. Once you start these other pieces, there's interfaces that are really difficult to parse out and make as an individual phase. So I'd love to answer questions about that, but I think it helps. It starts to help define knowing what we know about what money is available, where the first phase of work might fall.
Questions? So I have one sort of phase in question, Sherry. If our resources only allowed us to do the stuff that's in the priorities box, and we were to raise and relocate Shaw, but we did no renovations to it, would it be usable?
Yeah, that's a great question. It would be usable, yes. And we would also need to have a plan in place for ongoing improvement. So moving it and relocating it essentially replugs it in, electricity, water, sewer, in the same manner that it is right now. Then the building needs to be stabilized, basic stabilization once it's back down. It is definitely usable in that condition. There's no question. In the way that it's usable now. So I'm not saying that it needs to be reused in the exact same way. We wouldn't recommend it. But then the next phase of and what I mean by that specifically is we wouldn't use the third floor for storage. We would want to see the building used more in a more beneficial manner. But it is usable. In order for it to then reach its fullest potential, that's when the renovations come in. you know, the access, the fire protection, the, all of those pieces.
So follow up to that. So if we're only able to do the items that are in the priority box, what would happen to the stage? Would the stage stay where it is, or would it be relocated?
No, the stage would be relocated. So the existing, as you guys know, the existing platform is in the middle of the performance lawn. We would shift that back into the rail. And for the first year of this, that stage is likely a rented kit of parts. It's rented for the year. It's installed along that rail. We can hook it up to power, et cetera. And then this whole site area is available for audience.
So sorry to dominate the questioning, but my question, what I'm trying to figure out then is, if the stage is relocated back and we don't have enough funds to do the regrading of the lawn and the stage area, and we've removed two of the three structures, would that envision that we would have to have a trailer compound back on?
That's right.
It would have to be on Water Street almost, right?
That's right. We would have to figure out the back of house accommodations for that. And some of that, again, we can take a look at the first floor of the Shaw. There's certainly an adjacency there. I believe there would need to be some trailers until we're able to do the full renovation and additions that we had talked about.
Okay. Other questions?
I have a question, Tom.
Go ahead, Peter.
So on this, I noticed you moved the maintenance facility into phase one. So can you give us an idea of how much that would cost? And I guess my question is, I'll just make the statement, I would rather spend my money on the actual park than doing a maintenance facility and building something new. And the proximity of the maintenance facility to Pierce Island begs the question to me is, can't we use the facilities at Pierce Island to put this maintenance facility or whatever we need here out there and spend our money on the actual park?
Peter, I don't know if you want to chime in on that question or that statement.
I'm not sure which facilities you're referring to, Counselor. What facilities are out there that the maintenance facility would be relocated to?
You've got the wastewater treatment plant out there, and there's I mean, it's less than a half a mile away. I don't know what equipment you need to put in a new maintenance facility here, but I know this was not in the master plan, and it would be taking money away from actual park stuff.
Sure.
And it wasn't planned. So I was wondering if there's someplace else that we would be able to have storage or whatever equipment or whatever is in here, and focus on the main master plan in the park.
The answer is no. We don't have storage available up at the wastewater plant. It's all programmed for the wastewater plant. It would require building additional storage up there. The issue for us, I will do whatever the decision is, obviously. The challenge for us is there's a lot of material that's stored indoors in the winter. There's operational things that occur during throughout the park. There's mowers. There's all sorts of different equipment associated with operating the park that is currently located in the Shaw building and the addition to the Shaw building. It's fine if the decision is not to provide that information. We'll have to, or that storage, we'll have to figure out, where else to put it. It'll probably entail a little bit more operating costs because we'll have to truck stuff in and it'll slow down our efficiency. Every morning we'll have to, load stuff up, bring it in, and unload it and load it up at the end of the day. The intent is to try to have something local to the parks, but if there aren't resources available for that, it's understandable, and you know, we'll figure out how to support the park without that.
Okay, I guess my question on that would be, if it's just lawnmower and equipment like that, is it feasible to think we could get an estimate from a landscape company to do the same thing and eliminate that?
I'm sure we can look at privatizing the operation of the park.
Not the operation, just the maintenance.
The maintenance is the operation of the park.
Okay. I don't want to go into construction until we get the park stuff finished as far as maintenance goes. And I would hope that we could find another place to have storage and stuff like that.
Yeah, I would love that too. This is obviously a challenge that we're addressing or trying to address now with the existing conditions. We are at a premium in terms of available space at our facilities for our operations. So, I fully appreciate, needing to focus on the parks first. Maintenance of the park is part of parks. It has been located at the park throughout, and the desire is to reprogram the Shaw Building. If we don't reprogram the Shaw Building, we can continue to utilize that space and no new maintenance. So it could be phased. So in the near term, the Shaw Building could be utilized and continue to provide that function. And then when resources are available, the upgrades to the facility could be done such that it could be reprogrammed. It really comes down to whatever the decision through this group and what the council decides, we'll implement what decisions are made.
I mean, that sounds like a little better idea. I mean, I would rather see the park stuff get going. And if it so happens that we're not going to be using the Shaw in its full capacity, I mean, the maintenance facility can continue to be there until we flip it into use, if you want to call it that. I just wanted to put that out there so we're thinking about that. Thank you.
Okay. Other questions? Observations?
I have one. I'm just thinking, because part of what we're talking about here, am I correct, is what's going to be presented in the public discussions. Yes? Right. Yes.
Yes.
So I'm just putting myself in the place of someone who's not been privy to everything we've learned. And I, Genevieve, am clear, but I, audience member, am not totally clear why the change in grading in Water Street. And I'm wondering if there is a way, Sherry, to show what the flood pattern is now very clearly to someone who doesn't understand it and why that has to be changed. Because you use a lot of technical talk, which I understand because I've been following this. I've learned so much. It's fascinating to me. But I think if I'm coming into this and thinking, this is all about the park, why people only see what's on the surface. They see the trees, they see the lawn, they see the stage, and they don't understand that the infrastructure is the most important thing. So if there is a way to show us that before we get into why these changes have to be made, I think it would be helpful.
So I apologize if I didn't make that clear, but in the first public meeting, that's actually exactly what we intend to do. So we're going to revisit the master plan. We're going to emphasize the design goals for resiliency, preservation, and accessibility. And then we're actually going to do exactly that. Genevieve, we are going to lay out that enabling engineering that we've done. We're going to show the flood pathways as they exist. We're going to show the 2050 and 2070 projections that put the Shaw in a very vulnerable position. We're going to talk about the resilience preservation strategy that essentially amends the master plan and what that means, because the master plan had some proposals in it that thought about resiliency in a pretty simplistic way, because of course this was now 4 years ago, now we're looking at the current modeling and what how that informs that master plan. So that will all be laid out in this first meeting for exactly that reason, in very simplistic, accessible graphics and terms. And we want to allow plenty of time between the first meeting and the second meeting for people to ask exactly those questions. You know, explain to me again about the flood pathways or whatever. We want to introduce phase one in this first meeting and say, this is the area of the park that is most critical for addressing these things. And these are the things we're talking about. Give people time to digest it and ask questions and then come back in that second meeting. So this is the time people review it, they ask questions, that whole presentation is available online, the information about sea level rise and stormwater is available, and then that last meeting is when we say, okay, now that you've had a chance to digest this, here's how phase one will roll out. So I think you make a great point, and I totally agree with you. If we were just to come in sort of saying, okay guys, this is what we're doing, I think people would be really confused. So we wanna refresh everyone's memory and tell the same story we've been telling you guys over the course of our engagement with you, but do it in a, you know, it's just a little bit more of a consolidated way.
Great, thank you.
Other questions?
Yes, Sherry, just one sort of observation and two questions. As to the maintenance shed, I'm actually not in favor of privatizing any kind of landscaping activities within the park. You know, that park is even though it's sort of small and it looks sort of quaint, it's pretty complicated taking care of it and its aging infrastructure. And I think the knowledge and institutional knowledge that DPW has, which they got a lot from Michael, would make it much more efficient for DPW to just keep doing it. So I think that we would lose a lot if we privatize things, and I think it would actually be to the detriment of the park. I think maybe one thing we could consider is if that maintenance facility, somehow the cost of it could be shared by the park and DPW for the rest of Pierce Island. DPW is now for the first time maintaining both Pierce Island and the park. Up until about 2 years ago, it was just Pierce Island that they did. So that's my observation, kind of comment on that. And my two questions are, in this phase one, the pathway, I didn't exactly see that sort of clearly defined in the regrading of the performance lawn. And my second question is, where's the cost for the stage within the cost we have?
Okay, so agree with your thoughts on the DPW relationship with maintenance as far as how that facility could serve more than just the park. I think that's a great point. So, as you know, in the master plan, there is a proposal for a path that comes in on this corner, sweeps through the site, and allows there to be continuous movement. That would need to be implemented only partially in this early phase one. Phase one is likely to be broken out now into more than one piece just because of the heavy upfront infrastructure investment that needs to be made and the available funding. So taking, you know, one bite at a time, we would make sure that a pathway exists through here in the new plan, but that it's likely that as these other phases are implemented, that pathway may need to be adjusted because it needs to work in the short term with the existing conditions on either end of it, and then ultimately work in the long term. So that's what you were talking about, right? The pathway, the foot pathway, the pedestrian pathway. So that absolutely would be considered. You can sort of see here, my sense is there's an existing tree here that we want to preserve. So this path, the existing pathway shown right here, we'd want to slide that down and probably straighten it in this phase to accommodate this regrading, but it needs to connect on both ends. So it's going to be a little bit of an iterative process there.
Sherry, I have a follow-up question. And I'm not sure whether you can answer it or Peter can, but Peter had also asked what's going to cost to build this maintenance facility on Prescott Park? Because if that becomes immediately necessary as soon as we get to the raising and relocation of Shaw, any rough projections on what that would cost?
Peter, do you have a sense of what a facility like that would cost? It's something that I can look up and get back to you guys. I don't have it off the top of my head, but the intention with that, it would be a very economical structure. It's not, it's not a high design detailed structure. It is a true maintenance facility. And I don't know, Peter, if you have other input on that.
I mean, the prices range from $200 a square foot to, $400 a square foot, depending upon whether there's, we're going to have office space in there for the park, foreman, whether we just keep it a bare bones, high bay type of storage. And then, any administrative functions get done elsewhere. So it really, I don't see it, as Sherry said, I don't see it as being, hugely elaborate structure. The intent would to get, be utilitarian storage and means to operate. So it would need to be heated. So there would be some level of infrastructure within the building.
Okay, and we briefly discussed this the first session that we had, but I hadn't thought about the idea that you would have to truck your mowers and that type of stuff. Would you have to do that with the facility on Pierce Island, or would you be able to sort of walk them down the street, so to speak?
Well, currently we have a storage facility where this this proposed spot is shown. We have a shed over there which we have equipment in, and we because we've slowly been worked out of Shaw Building, we used to have the garage, the shed, and the bottom of Shaw. We now just have the garage and the shed. So because we were displaced from the garage portion, we needed a place to put something. So we have a small shed over towards the entrance of Fortrey Island, which, the operators do zip back and forth, with just getting back and forth. And they drive the mowers over, they grab the stuff, and they just go back and forth. So they're not loading on trailers per se, but they are moving back and forth. But as Beth indicated, we are doing maintenance on both Pierce Island, Fortrey Island, Prescott Park, and so there is some synergy relative to the activities between these areas, and there's a lot of back and forth that goes between the areas.
And so the thing that we briefly discussed was the possibility of a maintenance facility at the southern base. The little triangular piece that's on the very corner of Mechanic Street at the entrance to the bridge. It's the green area right there, exactly. Would that be a better location for the, for the various areas that you need to deal with in maintenance-wise?
So that area, that whole area, including, as you probably know, there's a pump station, not a small one, the biggest pump station in the city, adjacent to that lot. Alan is quite familiar with this. He lived with this for quite a while. The intent is when that pump station needs to be upgraded, which is identified to be done, the thought was, in order to address a number of things, would be that it would slide into the corner along the edge of the road, and that the pump station would be built into the hillside there. So the thought was that whole area was going to get reworked already. And that's been in the works for a number of years. And there hasn't been a formal design done. There hasn't been a formal public process done to do that, but that area was thought to be, you know, slated for that. The truck traffic and the types of activity in a pump station is not as frequent as a park maintenance facility. And the thought would be that if you had a lot more activity at that corner, in terms of mowers popping out, trucks popping out, it's already a challenging corner because of the grade going onto the bridge with Point of Graves there and all those different activities. It's a challenging area already. So I wouldn't want to add to that, you know, but that all being said, there has been no formal design done for the relocation of the pump station. There has been no, you know, public process for that. And therefore, you know, there are, all things are possible. And, you know, if the committee would like us, you know, we could look at that area to, you know, see if that could fulfill that, you know, location. And that would be, you know, it'd be fine. You know, it's relatively central to the park and Pierce Island, Fortress Island, so it would work fine. I just wouldn't want to move too far afield where we are either having to run equipment through neighborhoods or, you know, having to trailer everything.
So my concern, I can't remember who brought it up, about that area is affecting the neighborhood. You know, these guys get started very early in the morning and trucks back and forth, and they've just spent 4 years dealing with Pierce Island being renovated. I'd be careful of that neighborhood a little bit, but that's just my opinion.
My sense of this is that the optics of creating a new building at the time when we're really focusing on the crucial stuff of the infrastructure and the water issues and so on, even though it's small, if in fact we can do as Peter suggested, which would be to essentially maintain what we currently have and maybe use some of the ground floor of the Shaw, we would be better off postponing that piece to another stage. I'm afraid that we're gonna, people are gonna say that feels different or that feels like it's program dependent and we haven't really figured what the program for Shaw is. So that, you know, it's interesting that we apparently value all the important stuff that Sherry presented. And we also value the new facility, but the new facility feels like it could be postponed in that first stage.
Other questions? So a follow-up question, Sherry. In the Water Street stormwater phase, Water Street is raised about 4 feet. Am I correct in that understanding?
Yeah, we're nailing down exactly how high, but 3 to 4 feet is likely. Now, keep in mind, we do need to obviously meet Marcy Street at one end, so we need to be careful. I think what we may end up doing is splitting the difference, to be honest with you. We may end up having some below, some above grade. We also then need to take a very close look at the opposite side of Water Street, where there's those existing beautiful shade trees. Those are higher, actually, by 3 to 4 feet. So we need to make sure that the grades work there. And then, as you guys know, down at the end of Water Street, the grade actually does go up. So it's about fitting this intervention into the site in a way that finesses these interfaces with the existing conditions. So that would be part of the next round of our work, is really designing those exact details based on the modeling.
If I could just ask a follow-up question. I asked about where the cost for the temporary stage would be in the cost that we got. You know, just a reminder, I know this maintenance shed is really generating a lot of conversation, but, you know, I'm actually really in favor of it. And I think we have to remember that if the more lawn equipment we keep in the Shaw, the less it's going to be available for the festival to do back of stage stuff in the summer.
Right, right. So I apologize, Beth. I remember you asked about the stage. So that the first year, our intention was that it was going to be rented. So it actually, it would be an addition to these costs, but, and I'm trying to remember the exact number. It was in one of the previous presentations. So that first year, the stage would be rented, fit into that rail, connected to those utilities, but it would be in addition to these costs. I'll see if I can find that before the end of this meeting.
I think it was 330,000.
I thought 310, I was thinking. Somewhere like in the 300,000, yeah.
Yep, 310 is what was presented prior.
Thanks.
Okay, thanks.
I apologize. Something happened and I got cut out of the meeting, so I missed my, did you hear my question, Sherry?
Yes, and answered it really brilliantly, but I guess, no, I'm just kidding. actually, now we had another question since then, and suddenly I'm not, it was the grade question, the Water Street grade question. Yeah, I did talk about that. So we're looking at how that interface between Water Street fits with the rest of the site. The Liberty Garden side is higher, the sheaf is higher, and then the performance lawn is lower. So we're going to basically be mitigating those grade changes in between the two. So it may be that Water Street goes up 2 feet and that some of the infrastructure is 2 feet below, but then we're moderating again with the finished floor of the Shaw and the stage. So to be determined in the next round of engineering and design.
So, well, just so part of that question is when I look at the drawing for phase five, it looks like at the end of that process, the Shaw and the stage are sort of elevated. And if the road has been elevated, Water Street's been elevated behind it, are we going to end up channeling the water into the lower side of Prescott Park in the vicinity of the seating area?
So that's part of the stormwater strategy, actually, is that this performance lawn in major storm events is actually a stormwater management feature as well. So there will be subsurface infrastructure under this performance lawn, where in a really major storm event, stormwater may flow into this low spot, but then it gets released into like when the tide goes down and the stormwater subsides, it then flows out. It's just providing more capacity in a very directed area so that it doesn't inundate the more precious resources that we're trying to protect. This is one of the accommodate strategies. The seawall is to protect, the moving of the Shaw is to retreat, and then the Water Street and the performance lawn is to accommodate. And so it's this trifecta of strategies. So yes, actually, that is part of it, but it's also gonna be very managed. So it's not like it's gonna be this low wet area all the time. There will be subsurface infrastructure that allows that water to go. The biggest concern is a really major storm event. So there's a lot of rainfall at high tide with wind, right? So now we've got sea level is up, waves are coming in and stormwater is coming in. That's like the perfect storm. We're trying to make sure we've got accommodations for that so that the entire park doesn't flood or the neighborhood behind it's mitigated a bit. And that's part of that strategy.
Okay, so I guess a final follow-up on if we end up doing the initial seawall, the utilities, the Water Street stormwater, and raising and relocating Shaw, but we don't have the resources to regrade the lawn and the stage area in this phase. I would be concerned about having the stage at what is shown, what you were just showing it in that depiction number five, and then having to accommodate a lot of trailers and storage areas in that vicinity. And so I'm wondering if the stage shouldn't be relocated somewhere between what's proposed in this drawing and where it currently sits in order to accommodate the trailers in the, essentially in the line of Shaw line.
Yeah, that's actually a really great point. And one of the reasons that renting the stage that first year or first 2 years is potentially really smart, because it allows us to get the infrastructure in place. So you're right, Tom, it may be that first year, the stage actually ends up being here, and that trailers and other things end up being behind it or around it, but we're still then able to dedicate more lawn space and return the park in the park first, intent. It's a great point.
Other questions or comments?
I just, not to bring it back to the maintenance shed issue, but I just want to say I agree with Beth, but also to your point that opening up as much of the Shaw for backstage use is really important. And I don't see the maintenance shed on Pierce Island as other than the park. I see it as all part of the process. I mean, that's like saying, well, we built a house, but the well is outside, so we're not going to do the well today. You still need it. It's just all part of the program. So I don't see that as a concern.
Other questions, comments? Okay. What next, Sherry?
So next, let's talk dates, I think is the best thing. I'll just go back to the overall slide. So Nancy, we had taken a look at a couple of dates, and I'm just gonna bring them up. We had looked at September.
Yeah, pursuant to your schedule, Sherry, I think September 15th was the date that worked best with you.
That's for the kickoff. Yes, it's a Tuesday night, September 15th. You had checked the city council calendar and other calendars. And so that's what we're proposing as like the first virtual meeting, where we, to Genevieve's point, revisit the master plan, talk about the enabling engineering, lay everything out, introduce what a phase one might include. How does that look for you guys?
That's fine. That's fine with me.
Fine with me.
Okay.
Okay, go ahead, Alan.
I think so. I have a medical procedure the previous day, but I think I'll be okay.
Well, we hope so.
Thank you.
All right, well, let's plan on the 15th then for the initial meeting.
We have a time?
Yeah, we were thinking of, I think we were thinking generally like 6 to 7:30 or 6:30 to 8, but I think starting earlier and allowing, if we needed to have a little bit more time at the end for Q&A, is probably prudent.
Yeah, I'd be inclined to start at 6:30 as opposed to 6 for people who are commuting from somewhere home, just to give them an opportunity to get there.
Sure, that's fine.
And Sherry, what are you thinking for this panel's participation in that?
Good question.
Event.
So I think we definitely want at least as many of you as can attend attending in real time, so that you can hear folks' comments firsthand. I think if the public has questions specifically for the Blue Ribbon Committee, that's a great opportunity. We certainly had times during the master plan where the public had very specific questions for the Blue Ribbon Committee. And I think really it's, you're just there to listen and then answer questions as they come up. So I don't see a presentation role per se, but I think just being an active participant in the conversation is what's most important at this stage.
I wonder if it's possible to have the materials that are going to be discussed at that session available for people to review, download, like 5, 6, 7 days in advance of the meeting.
We had spoken about the possibility of this committee meeting to review a draft presentation, if possible, on September 4th, which is actually next Friday. I don't know how that looks for people. And it may be a little aggressive for Sherry, but.
We'll at least be close, I think. that's what we were thinking, is to have another meeting with this group so that you could see it, validate it, and then we would be prepared to roll it out early, have it up on the website as part of the meeting announcement, all of that. Because truly, the materials are all there. You know, we've got them all together. We just need to finesse it into one presentation. So I'll be working with Savvy to do that over the next couple of days.
I apologize. I have another commitment that I need to go to, and I just wanted to let you know I'll be signing off. It's good to see everybody.
Thanks, Peter.
Bye, Peter. Have a good day.
Thank you, Peter.
Okay. So the materials that you're envisioning as part of what we'll look at next week, will those include the engineering studies and everything that have been done on the flooding? Okay.
Exactly. It'll be a draft of the public presentation. It might have a placeholder or two, but like I said, most of the information is already created. We just need to reformat it so that it's all in one presentation. So we would run through that with you guys, make sure it makes sense, make sure it's intuitive, make sure it's telling the narrative, you know, saying the things that we all agree it should say. And that would be really helpful to us, because then we'd be able to finesse that and finalize it ahead of the public meeting.
Okay. What is everybody's availability to meet next Friday morning?
Time is that thing.
Okay.
I'm all set.
I can do it.
Okay. I'm available. Is there anybody who can't do it?
I don't know. I'll commit now and then adjust accordingly.
Okay. All right, so 9 o'clock again?
Yes, please.
Yes.
Okay. All right. And do you want to pick the date for the second meeting, Sherry?
Oh, yes. So then we had looked towards October, and we were thinking Thursday the 29th. October the 29th, which is a Thursday.
It says here week one. 20, isn't the 29th like week four?
It's no, of October.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, I see meeting. That. Oh, this right. That's online. An online content review. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Great. Yep.
Who is not available on that date? All right. Well, we'll go with that one for the second meeting then.
Great.
But also an evening
meeting?
Same
time frame?
Yeah. Same time frame. Yep.
Okay. And as far as the daytime schedules you're envisioning, do you want to set those today, or are those something that you would develop and see who's available at that time?
I think let us put that presentation together, and then we'll pick a couple times with the city team that at least, you know, one of them can be available, and then we'll check in with you guys to make sure one of you can be available. But I'm thinking there's one midday, maybe one morning and one evening in this
that's a good idea.
Late September, early October time frame.
Okay. All right. That works. Okay.
Great.
Anything else, Sherry, before I come back?
Nope. That's okay. It for me.
All right. So It seems to me at this point that what we need to do is kind of decide as a committee what we think about what has just been discussed as a potential recommendation for phase one. I think I'm not sure we need to hear any more information, but if we do, let me know. But how do people feel about this concept that has been fleshed out this morning of this sort of phase one or breaking phase one into two parts, depending upon financial resources, which I think would envision a recommendation to the city council that the master plan be adjusted to, relocate, a couple of changes. One, the removal of the structures, the relocation of Shaw and the removal of the two side structures, the relocation of the stage, and the reorientation of the seating bowl. Those, I think, are the major changes in the master plan. I don't think we need to make a decision on issues like temporary versus permanent stage or anything of that nature at this point. But I'm open to thoughts. But is that the concept that you're thinking you'd like to develop by next week for something to present to the public? Sherry?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So thoughts or comments on that?
Tom, I think that it's, I would like to go to the public with everything in phase one, regardless of the cost. And I'm not, minimizing the cost, but I think that it is really important that we get the public's input on all of this. And therefore, when we go to perhaps pick or choose to make our recommendation to the council, we've been assured of hearing from the public and having had the public weigh in on all of it, because we may as a committee decide not to do the wall and not to put that out to the public. But then when we go to the nitty gritty and start to do our final determinations, if that all of a sudden pops up as something that's really important, we haven't asked the public anything about that. So I think it's important to sort of perhaps endorse this as a broad outline and concept and get everybody's input into it rather than start to pick and choose at this point.
When you say the entire phase one, then are you envisioning everything I just said, plus the regrading of the lawn areas, the design of the sort of the sweeping roads and things of that nature?
Yes, the what was in the priorities and then the box underneath it.
Okay, are you envisioning?
Can we go back to that slide? Thank you.
So are you, hold on, let me find that slide. And this, are you thinking we should also have a sort of adopted a concept of what the stage will look like ultimately and, the addition of new buildings and that type of thing?
Well, the stage, the buildings, perhaps a concept, because I do think that that is important, especially since you are now considering putting new buildings into a very historic area and sort of a concept of what they're going to look like. And I think perhaps their mass and scale. I think the stage is kind of, it is what it is. It's whatever we rent. And it's not staying up year round. So I think the aesthetics of that are perhaps a little bit less important.
Others thoughts on that?
Well, yeah, I thought that for this initial part, we were just talking about a temporary rented stage So that's for later. I have a lot of thoughts on that, but that's not part of phase one from what I understand. So.
Well, let me just try to frame this issue again. So when we're originally talking about phase one, essentially, if you go back to the draft phasing plan that showed the different areas that we're going to look at. Actually, it's the phase one scope plan. I'm not sure what page that is, Nancy, but yeah, that's it right there. So that if we're looking at the entire phase one, then we're looking at everything that includes within that blue highlighted area, that would include the stage, it would include, you know, redoing Water Street, you know, relocating or removing buildings, et cetera. So that's what I'm trying to flesh out. Beth's thought is, I understand, Beth, you're saying we ought to have a consensus on this committee as to our adoption of the entire phase one before we go to the public. And so that, I'd like to focus on that, whether that's necessary or not. So I hear you saying, Genevieve, that we don't need to address the stage, which otherwise would be part of stage one.
Well, that was just my understanding from when Sherry presented today. So maybe I'm misunderstanding that.
Yeah, I think what's getting a little bit complicated, and this is helpful to understand as we head into the public meeting, is that we parsed out the entire park in areas that would allow us to complete improvements and have them relate to existing conditions or new conditions in a way that allowed the park to continue to function. Now, within those parcels, they're subsets based on available funding. If we had all the funding in the world, we would do the first phase in total. So Tom's correct in that if we were to do all of phase one, that would mean all of Water Street, you know, the regrading of the performance lawn, pathways, the stage relocation. And again, I still, no matter what, I think renting it the first year is the right thing to do as we, you know, continue to put this in motion. And then dealing with those seawalls. This is really in total. So what we did is we then broke it down into order of operation and interdependencies within that, based on the fact that funding is not, it doesn't seem like you're going to have all the money at once. So it's true, each of those components, you know, that get you to this full build out are part of phase one.
I mean, in some ways, we really, I mean, technically, because we're talking about the parts that change the master plan, and those are technically the parts that only need to go back to the public, so to speak, because the other stuff has been vetted. We talked about infrastructure improvements. We talked about the seawalls. A temporary stage was part of the master plan. So in reality, the only thing that we really need to talk to the public about is raising and relocating the Shaw and the tear down of the lean-to in the garage, because that's really technically the only new part of the master plan. That's the only part that's being amended. But, you know, I think since we're going out to the public anyway, it's fine to get impact on the other stuff that was initially part of the master plan.
Yeah, relocating the seating area is also part of, is a change in the master plan.
Yeah, exactly. Those are the things that are really changing. So, I mean, if we wanted to be just really focused, we could just do that. You know, I'm sort of amending my thing here, but, you know, I don't know if we want to go for efficiency or maximum sort of input from the public, but, you know, we could just decide to go for the things that are just amending the master plan.
Other members of the committee on the whole issue of whether we can just break this into a smaller piece and make recommendations or whether we need to address all of phase one.
Oh, I kind of agree that we should address all of it, because I want to make sure that that the stage is going to be usable next summer or whenever. I don't remember the timeline on this, Sherry, but we still need to make sure that it is available for the arts festival. So I kind of want to make sure that we have the phases planned. So maybe if we show this is phase one, this is what we're looking at now, and Sherry could present phase two, phase three, and how that's going to fit in. But I think the way we're going now is good. I especially like the explaining of why we're doing the mitigation first and going through all of that. So everybody, like was discussed, everything is out to the public that we saw. And this is our reasoning behind it, to protect it first and then start in phases. Everybody's gonna know that we're not gonna have this done in 1 year. It probably won't be 2 years, 3 years, depending on funding, depending on timelines of construction and stuff like that. But I think the other thing is, when people start looking at this, they're gonna say, okay, so when is it gonna be done? When can we get back in there? So doing a complete phase, I think, is a great idea also. So I would kind of encourage us to discuss the whole phase and the implications on that. And so I like going that way. I guess that's my comment, Tom.
Okay,
and thank also you, if I'm not mistaken, Tom, that we talked about that the park was never going to be closed to the public, that the work was going to be maybe in the shoulder season so it could be open in the summer. I don't know if that's still the case here, but that we weren't going to close the park completely for like a whole year or anything.
Right. So that's something that we will need to strategize about depending on what funding is available. If we're working on the seawalls, that can potentially happen while the existing stage is still in place. You know, let's assume by next summer, the virus is under control and we're back and the arts festival is back in action. It's likely that for spring and summer, we'd focus on the seawall work and the infrastructure there. And then we'd wait till the end of the season to then dip into the other parts of the site that would have a more immediate impact on the use of the park for the arts festival. So we'd let that proceed, arts festival would finish, and then we'd get into the rest of that and try to get as much done by the following season. So
right.
That's
and that's what was presented to the public originally. So
that's right.
I think, right. You know, continuing in that method is a good idea. Thanks.
I think this may be reiterating what people have said, but I think it's important that we begin by framing the biggest picture we can so that people are grounded in that. But then the bulk of the meeting is clearly focused on the first part of phase one that we really need to focus on and move on and get approval for and input on. So that I think we need to do both. I think one without the other is not as helpful.
Okay, that seems to be the consensus. So let me make this suggestion for
Tom, can I just say one quick thing? Because I absolutely agree. And I think some of it's just semantics because English is such a limited language. Because phase one, as Alan just said, is everything. But then maybe call something else. Like within phase one, there are six steps. And we're focused on these four steps first. Something like that, just to restructure it, because I think it gets really confusing when we talk about, well, it's phase one of phase one.
Yeah, no, I agree. And you say step, Alan said part. I mean, you know, let's put aside the logistics, but so let's see if we can develop a committee consensus on what I'll call the entire phase one picture. And so, we're talking about, forget about whether it's prioritizing or not, but right now we'd be envisioning stabilizing the seawalls and improving the utilities, the stormwater improvements, particularly on Water Street, but in general, the improvements of the electrical service, that type of thing, replacing the main transformer, the raising and relocating Shaw closer to Marcy Street, the other raising, RAZ, the two additions to Shaw, ultimately replacing those additions with something, a building, one building or a building and a stage or something. The renovation of Schaeff and the regrading and the lawn area and the stage area with the stormwater, extra stormwater resiliency. And as part of that, it would include reorienting the seating bowl from what I'll call sort of diagonal in the park to one that is parallel with the water. So if that, if I've accurately described phase one, maybe you could tell me if I've missed anything, Sherry. But if that is a summary of the total picture, I'd like to get the committee's comments on that. Now, what I have specifically not made a decision on at this point, and I have done this advisedly, is whether the stage is going to be a permanent or a seasonal stage, that type of thing. Ultimately, that will come into play in making the decision what the new buildings would look like. But I'm a little concerned about going down a rabbit hole on the stage issue that will slow this entire process and have us lose the opportunity to get this project off the ground. So,
right.
How do people feel about that summary?
That's fine with me.
Okay. Anything missed there, or are you comfortable with that as an initial recommendation to the public for their comment and review?
Well, if you could just, because I have sort of short-term memory, could you just put up the priority slide again? I just want to see if there's anything else on there.
Yeah, the phase one cost summary slide. The only thing that's really not in there that we discussed is whatever cost would be for sort of upgrading or replacing the maintenance facility on Pierce Island.
Yeah, I'll add maintenance facility, I'll add stage rental, and Beth, I'll also add at the end of this sort of surface restoration, because once all of this is in place, we do want to strategize about some of these things, like if we improve the wall, that means the chain link fence is coming down. Like there's some parts and pieces to this that I just want to distill out. So I may add one more thing that sort of puts a bow on phase one, ties it up. It's less dollars, but it's sort of the piece that everyone's going to interface with.
Great. All right. Other comments on that?
I think that sounds great. I think we're having everything included in there, and I don't know. I don't disagree with Beth, but I like to have the dollars there so everybody can see, have all the data to look at. And I also think that I would not have any problem with Sherry taking away the chain link fence. I would be more than happy to see anything there but the chain link fence. So if that could be included, that would be great. And I guess the other stuff is any of the aesthetics that you could put in there that would make it pop for the public would be great. The only other question I have is, since we're doing the mitigation in this one section and phase two looks like it's over where the fountains are, are we going to have to redo anything when we get to the phase four that's on the other side, as far as the mitigation of the water? Yeah.
No, all of the work that we're doing, the intention is that nothing needs to be touched. things might be added on to. There's a point where seawalls interface, but no work, the intention is that no work is undone. Everything can be built upon to interface together and work as a complete cohesive plan.
Yeah, because I guess my concern is if we don't have funding or we don't get to this in the phases in time, that the park is still going to be open and usable by, you know, the art festival and everybody else as we go through this. So that would be my only other concern.
For sure. And I think it's going to be important. These are details that we'll just keep you guys abreast of. But in the specifications for construction, managing public access and safety through this entire thing, that's going to be a project-wide consideration.
The only other question I would have is if we put out phase one and we're all good with that, and then we show the public phase two, three, and four, we show them this diagram, how do we react if the public comes back and says, the consensus is, well, could we do phase four as phase two instead of this? Can we react to that or not?
We can react to that. These phases have been sequenced in a way that not only supports the park first strategy, but also the resilient preservation strategy. So we can walk through why we sequenced them this way. Four and five, and then consequently six, are really the least vulnerable of the park. One is most, two is second, three, and then four. So the sequence of operations is actually logical as part of that resilient preservation strategy.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm mindful of what Tom said about this kind of degenerating into a discussion of the stage and some where the stage becomes located eventually, and some of those issues that seem to me to be less crucial right now to get a sense. The big picture needs to be out there, but we really need to get a sense of that priorities box in terms of the discussion at the first meeting and gathering input. And I think to simply make that statement, here is phase one and all that's included, but today we're going to focus on this key part, because I think to seek approval and input on anything bigger than that may make this a very long meeting.
Thank you, Alan. Okay, so I don't think I need to take a roll call, but what I'm perceiving is that we have a consensus on the concept of what phase one, the big phase one, would include. And I don't see there's any dissent on that. So I'm going to go with that. And so then, whether it's step one or part one, our proposal would be to recommend that we do what we call the phase one priorities as step number one. And so that would be, again, without repeating them, the items that are in the box on the phase one cost summary. Do we have a consensus on that as well? I see Alan nodding.
That's yes. A yes.
Go ahead, Genevieve.
Can we just put the slide up again?
Okay.
Nancy, I hear you laughing.
I had heard Sherry was going to add the cost of a temporary stage and the maintenance facility.
Maintenance building and then
the box.
Any surface. Yeah.
Clarify that. Yeah.
Yes, I'm saying I agree. One question I'm just thinking about, if I'm coming from the public, is, and I know that you presented this the last meeting, Nancy, but I don't remember, what of this money has already been committed or acquired and what would still have to be raised?
Yeah,
and I can. I'm not asking that question right now. I'm just saying you may get those questions.
Yeah, I think that we've planned for this implementation through the CIP, but we can afford a project on the low end, and the high end kind of we're going to have to pick and choose maybe according to the current schedule that we have in the CIP. So we'll have that available.
Maybe if we could add that to this cost summary sheet, and sure. So everybody knows where we are. And I guess my understanding of that is it has been approved and it's in the CIP, but we would still need to go out and bond for this. Is that correct, Nancy?
Correct.
And during this COVID time, I hate to remind everybody, but it's not the best time to go and do this, but I think everybody should be aware of that. And I think it would be great if it was at the bottom too, so everybody knows where the city's at, that we are in support of this, but there's a COVID effect to this also.
Right.
So and also sure. Just some understanding of, you know, the CIP, there's FY21, there's FY22, you know, how much of the CIP can we use for phase one over the fiscal years? I was sort of looking ahead and wanting to borrow from FY22, but I don't know if that's really possible. So in other words, of the CIP, how much of it can be allocated towards phase one, so to speak. It's a crude question. I know it's much more complicated than that, but just some understanding of that. We don't need that now, but.
Right.
You know, if we're going to bond some of this, interest rates are low. There's the good news.
I would even suggest that what we might consider is, what I hear us saying right now is the items that are boxed out on that summary is step one of phase one. I would suggest that we take the remaining three items there and either break those into maybe two additional steps so that as people look at this, they know what's coming next. So renovating, obviously renovating the Shaw is a big ticket item, so that might be step two of phase one. And then the new construction again, because it's a big ticket item. Each of those perhaps are steps in and of themselves. How do people feel about that?
I think that's a great idea.
So yeah. maybe what we do is we outline them as phase 1A, phase 1B, phase 1C. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
So my other kind of observation or comment would be I don't want our graphics to lead people to the conclusion that certain details of what might be phase 1B, 1C, et cetera, are predetermined. So for instance, ultimately I'm a little up in the air myself on whether, you know, the seating bowl should be as large as it is on the, I look at like the phase one scope drawing. I raised this at our last meeting. It's a considerable expansion of the existing facility, the existing stage or seating area, which I'm in favor of, but I'm not quite convinced that it needs to be that large. And it looks like it impinges more on the concession stand than
yeah. Tom, we're going to update this graphic so that the concession buildings are shown and that it doesn't extend all the way beyond these trees. It's actually interior to those existing shade trees. So we'll adjust this and we'll update that to show that. We'll also amend the phase one limits just so that they fit better within the proposed improvements. But the oval is really in here. It stops where that hand is now. And then the concession building and other things exist behind it. So we'll adjust that.
Okay. Well, if you recall that one of the things that we discussed at the master planning level originally was the idea that the walkway would create a natural I don't want to say barrier, but a natural definition of the seating area. And that if it was necessary at some point for the arts festival to put roping in, that type of thing, that it would be done within the inner circle, so to speak, of that walkway, so that we would get away from the what people refer to as the toll booths, that type of thing. Do you still see that as something that would be incorporated into the redesign?
Can you repeat that last part? You broke up just a little bit at the end.
Okay, I'm sorry. So when we were going through the master planning process, there were a number of people who spoke to the concern about needing to have a free and open flow of people through the park.
Correct.
And so we had actually discussed how the walkway could end up being a natural definition of the boundaries, yes, of the seating area. And then, yeah, if the arts festival needed to put up stanchions or something to sort of, you know, keep people in, so to speak, that they wouldn't need to they could do it within the inner circle of the,
that's right,
way. So my yeah, question is, go ahead.
I was just going to say, we were going to build in sleeves to, if that was necessary.
Okay. So in this case, would that mean that when you come to this next rendering, that the walkway itself will move inside that tree, that row of trees right now where the...
That's correct.
Okay, all right.
Yep. Right in here, yep.
But the whole, I'm not trying to micro design the project at this stage, but my experience has been that people will remember the drawings long after they've forgotten the conversations or whatever they've read. So I don't want to get people locked into seeing something and then, you know.
No, it's a great point. And that was just a miscommunication on our part. I wanted to update this and I didn't review it closely enough. So we will update that. You'll see it next Friday.
Okay. All right.
Can I ask another question, Tom? Yeah. Tom, on top of yours, Sherry, would we be able to add the new capacity of the stage area compared to the old?
Sure.
To Tom's point, so we could actually see how we adjusted and how it will be adjusted?
Yeah. And I think capacity is a tricky thing because right now with the stage here, people fill the whale lawn and the public forum area and they really, in a big event, fill every last nook and cranny. So technically, you know, the existing quote unquote performance lawn is really this area, but we know that in a big event, there's people in kayaks there, you know, it's really, there's people everywhere. By sliding the stage back, even to here, in an interim condition, what we're allowing then is for this core area of the lawn to support the audience and then have this pathway that is unencumbered. And then these areas are not part of that performance lawn, right? And so if the arts festival wants to, as Tom was saying, fence off the performance area, that's happening in here. And so if you want to be in this center lawn area, you're crossing into the arts festival area. But that this pathway that we're proposing here, that's the limit. And they don't control that during their performances. So I will we'll diagram that so it's a more clear communication.
Thank you. Sorry, Tom.
That's right. Other comments or thoughts? Okay, so I think we have, we've given Sherry our instructions on what we're looking for. I think we have a consensus on it. Do I need to summarize it or are we okay? Okay, I see a lot of thumbs up. Thank you. All right, so do we need a formal vote on this, Nancy, at this point or?
No, I think that we can choose next Friday to be the point at which the committee endorses the materials to be presented to the public.
I agree. Okay, excellent. Good work this morning. Unless anybody has any new business or they'd like to bring up, I'd like to open up the public comment period. Okay, I don't see any visitors, Nancy, so you're in charge.
We have Stephanie Secor, the city's public information officer, who has her hand raised.
That's Stephanie, and Stephanie, please identify yourself and your address, and if you're here on behalf of somebody for whom you're representing.
Sure. Stephanie Secord, Public Information Officer for the City of Portsmouth. I've been following the entire meeting with great interest and excitement. Sherry, you and I obviously have to dovetail what your plan is and your collateral and materials with the public information process for the city. We always inform the City Council first of anything that goes out before it goes to any member of the public. So I'll work with you on that. Make sure we get all of the stuff on the website, which I know Nancy is close to in terms of the plans and all of that stuff. But we've got an advisory that goes to about 5,000 residents and is shared on 3 different Facebook groups. So we'll dovetail all of that, but just a couple of quick technical details. One is, it struck me that in your schematics, the 3D drawings, the buildings of the moved Shaw seem a little out of proportion, and I was just struck by that. So I think—
Yeah, that's a good point. We'll take a look at that. We do have to raise it, which I think is what we're trying to show, but we'll adjust that. I agree with you. It looks a little funky.
Yeah. The second thing is that I do think it's useful to lay out the master plan, and as Beth said, what has already been approved, because you will get public input that suggests starting the whole conversation all over again. So I think it's useful to define what is approved, what, like the seawalls and the water infrastructure, and to Tom's point, then go into the things that are changes to that master plan that we'd have to go back to the City Council for. And then the last point is that next Friday at 9:00, there is a ribbon cutting for the Senior Activity Center, which might involve Peter and others who would normally be on this meeting. So I just wanted to flag that for what it's worth. I mean, that's Nancy's.
Yep, I think we're okay with that, Stephanie. Thank you.
That's it.
Thank you, Stephanie. And by the way, congratulations. And for those who don't know, Stephanie is brand new in her position, and you can see why she was hired, because she knows her stuff. Thank you.
Actually, I've been doing this since last July, but I'm now doing it full time. And I, as of right now, there's a new director of marketing at Strawberry Bank, which was my previous position, and my assistant has been promoted. So thank you, John.
Thank you. Who's next, Nancy?
I don't see, we have Courtney Perkins in the meeting, but I don't see your hand raised for any comment. And that's it. Oh, she just raised her hand.
Hi everyone, Courtney Perkins. I am coming to you from the Shaw Building. And I just would like appreciate the commentary around the stage and the phasing. But I think based on what we've seen in previous meetings and work that Sherry has done, we had the sort of 25-year cost impact of the site-built stage versus a purchase stage and then a rental stage. And I think material impact on cost as well as the festival's capacity to assist the city in sort of public-private fundraising for a stage. So I just would like some clarity around whether the public would see those figures, because I think that may impact some of their choices, or whether that comes at a later date based on the discussion of the committee.
Well, for my response would be that I think that comes in the later phase. And so as Sherry suggested, what we're really talking about is a, you know, very temporary stage, performing stage during this phase 1A, because we're really not, until we do the regrading and complete the what I'll call phase two and add the additional buildings, I'm not sure we're really in a position to decide on that permanent versus seasonal stage. I don't think either one is precluded, although the master plan envisioned it would be a seasonal stage. So that would be another conversation for another day.
Thank you.
Other observations, Courtney?
Sorry about that. No, thank you. Just some clarity. I appreciate your comments, Tom.
You're welcome. Anybody else, Nancy?
No, that's it.
Okay. Well, I think it's been a very good meeting. I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Okay, a quick roll call. Genevieve?
What am I?
there's a motion to adjourn.
Oh, yes, let's adjourn.
Okay. Alan?
Let's adjourn.
Petra?
Yes.
Beth?
Yes.
Robin?
Yes.
And the chair votes yes. Thank you all. We'll see you next Friday morning.
Great meeting.
Thank you, Sherry. That was great. Really
thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Sherry. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.